Good afternoon. Police are pleading for drivers to slow down this Christmas, with another three people dead on Victorian roads in 24 hours, pushing the state's road toll to almost 300. Mark Santomartino reports.
291 people have died on Victoria's roads this year. That's 57 more than this time in 2022. And as of last night, that includes a man in his 20s and a woman in her 40s, both from the ACT. Their Mercedes was battered beyond recognition by a B-double truck at an intersection about 50 minutes' drive south of Robinvale on the New South Wales border.
So at this point, it seems like the Mercedes sedan has come through a give way sign in front of the B-double.
Investigators don't yet know where they were going or why they were in Chinkapook last night. The truck driver, who escaped with only minor injuries, was delivering carrots from a local farm.
Despite lots of messaging from all the road safety authorities, we're still seeing people dying in the few days before Christmas.
Police have just confirmed a 73-year-old who fell off an e-scooter at Templestowe this week died in hospital. He wasn't wearing a helmet at the time. Separately, a woman in her 80s is also fighting for life tonight after being cut from the passenger seat of another car crumpled by a truck at Geelong this morning.
If the conditions aren't perfect, just slow down. The main message is to plan ahead, think about any journey that you're taking and concentrate on the task at hand.
Speed is often what's killing people on Victoria's roads, but heading into a rainy Christmas, the TAC says distraction, fatigue, drugs and alcohol are equally as dangerous during longer drives on unfamiliar roads.
Mourners have started paying their respects to the victims of the Prague University shooting as new body cam footage shows the moment police searched room to room for the gunman. Europe correspondent Edward Godfrey has more.
A memorial is growing here at the Charles University in the heart of Prague's historic old town. As we learn more about this tragedy, police have released body cam vision from when it was unfolding, and it is harrowing, it is quite haunting vision. You can see the police officers, very brave officers, charge into the building. As soon as they get into the foyer area, you can hear screams coming from the floors above. They move up the stairs frantically, but also methodically. They go up in single file, and you can see they work through the corridors, going from room to room, forcing their way into at least one room, looking for this gunman. This is all happening while the gunman, David Kozak, was opening fire on his fellow classmates and innocent people on the street below, we know now, killing at least 14 people and injuring dozens more. The memorial has been growing. It's started in the early hours of the morning after the incident, people coming from all over to light candles and lay flowers and to pay their respects.
My brother studied at Charles University, so I think it's to pay respect for those who fallen here.
This is not usual here, so it's shock.
It's the least we could do.
The police have revealed they found, in their words, an unbelievable amount of ammunition inside the university, and they say this could have been even worse than it is if it wasn't for their quick response. They were here within 4 minutes, they say. We know Kozak killed his father before coming here and committing this harrowing attack, but we've also had confirmation from ballistics tests that a weapon found at his home matches that used to kill a man and his two-month-old daughter in a forest outside the town just a week ago. Those investigations are continuing. A memorial here at the university continues to grow. Lots of candles have been lit here and placed on the steps, flowers laid, messages left here, stretching along the road here, right along the front of the university, right where this incident unfolded. This has had a profound impact on people here in Prague and right across the country. This is going to be something that they won't forget anytime soon.
Western Australians forced to flee their homes during raging bushfires are beginning to return, many thankful to firefighters who saved their properties. Rachel Clifford has more.
You can see how dangerously close the flames came to homes and sheds, bushland turning to ash. 831 hectares in all now lie scorched after this fire tore through this semi-rural suburb southeast of Perth. Strong westerly breezes putting pressure on crews and homeowners defending their properties, some just metres from flames.
So much emotion going through me right now. God, just how fast it can happen. 1 minute to watch an act, next minute, get out of there.
150 professional and volunteer firefighters were here on the ground, supported by tankers and helicopters in the air. The fire is not controlled, but authorities say it is contained and lines surrounding the site are being strengthened.
This fire running at 2 kilometres, nearly 2 kilometres per hour yesterday, would have been really, really harrowing for the local community. And I guess it's a really important reminder that now is the time to prepare a bushfire plan. Perhaps the best Christmas gift you could give your loved ones is preparing a bushfire plan. The cause of the fire is still undetermined and there's still investigations ongoing between WA Police and the Department of Fire Emergency Services on the cause.
Crews managing to save as many as 40 homes during the blaze.
Meanwhile, a suspicious grass fire has come within metres of a home north of Adelaide. Security cameras captured the blaze ripping through the property around 2 this morning.
Metres from the shed from my sheds, about probably 50 metres from the house.
I was moving towards the residence and the first arrival appliance was quite concerned.
There was no major damage, but the owner says it's the 5th time his home has been targeted in 2 decades. The future of Australia's economy is set to be led by young people in their 20s. According to a major review of our population, federal politics reporter Fiona Willen explains.
There's a growing population of younger Australians. This is from the government's annual population statement. It forecasts there'll be 30.9 million people in Australia by 2034, up from 26 million in 2022. And there'll be a shift in the age breakdown. The data shows the most common age in Australia this year is 33. By 2033, the most populous age will be 27. That's largely driven by the arrival of young migrants, as well as a push by the former coalition government in the early 2000s for families to have more babies, with incentives such as the baby bonus.
That was a policy that had a direct impact on Australia's age profile today. And it's those young people coming through our population now that are going to be able to provide additional support and tax receipts into the older population as well as we age as a society.
Treasurer Jim Chalmers flagged an ageing population as one of the key economic challenges for his government. Experts say the rise of young Aussies into the workforce will help offset some of those extra costs.
Melbourne scientists have created a simple at-home blood test that could accurately detect type 1 diabetes. 100 Victorian children and young adults took part in the world-first study, which confirmed the simple finger prick test produces accurate results.
Real innovation here is for the first time ever we've shown that we can do this accurately. We're the first team in the world that's been able to do that.
Type 1 diabetes affects about 6,500 children under the age of 14 across Australia. Well, with just over 30 hours to go until the clock officially ticks over to Christmas, Australians are hitting the shops for the last-minute festive rush to finish those lists. Emily Rice has more.
While many of us are reining in our spending this year, some Aussies make an exception for Christmas. Here at Chadstone, the biggest shopping centre in the Southern Hemisphere, it was busy, but certainly not bedlam, with some 500 retailers to choose from.
Foot traffic still exceptionally strong, 500,000 through the week leading up to Christmas.
Centre manager Daniel Boyle says going to the bricks and mortar stores is the only way to guarantee you'll have that precious last minute gift in your hand come Monday.
I wouldn't be going anywhere near online shopping. I'd be coming in, I'd be seeing it, and I'd be taking it away with me.
While Boxing Day is traditionally when the sales start, some retailers are getting in early with heavy price reductions.
Reduce what I'm spending on my boyfriend, but my niece and nephew, they're getting spoiled this year.
Never too much on Christmas presents.
For little Athena, this time of year is doubly exciting, as today is her 5th birthday.
Happy birthday to you.
While adults may find the last minute shopping situation stressful, it's a sweet time of year for the kids.
I like it about Christmas when Santa comes to our house.
Merry Christmas, everybody.
Technically, there's only one day left until Santa arrives, but with most major shopping centres having extended hours, there's still plenty of time to find that perfect gift.
And thousands of Sydneysiders are making a mad dash to the fish markets this afternoon. Officials are expecting up to 140,000 shoppers across the weekend.
We set the alarm for about 5 o'clock this morning. Yeah, we've come down from Newcastle.
We're looking for anything and everything. Some of the bits unusual, a bit special.
Prawns, oysters and some lobsters.
Sashimi, scallops, and I'm going to get some ling. We're going to have a seafood Christmas.
More than 350 tonnes of seafood will be sold, with the markets open until 5 p.m. tomorrow night.